Hi everyone. Week 12. Woohoo! We finish off with normal distribution, which may not sound like Z scores, but it sort of is. These last 2 weeks are intertwined, as I said last week, and hopefully they actually will be the same week soon. But let's look at it. What's normal distribution? Firstly, let's introduce it with Z scores, because, well, we just did them, and what I'm going to talk about is, say, and introduce this normal curve, but do it via Z scores. Now, I'm going to say, imagine this is working. There we go. This is some frequency versus score situation. Let's just pretend it was, you know, marks in an exam again, and the average was maybe 60. A lot of people got 50. Some got 40. Not many got 30, so on. Lots got 70. Some got 80. Not many got 90. And I could do columns, and maybe I'd have big columns here and little columns here. But in general, it might end up looking like, oh, that's just not that bad. So let's look at my thing. That curve is just meant to be like what I've got over here. All of these columns becoming a curve. And all I'm saying is that, look, most of my results are around 60. There were still a lot of results around 50 and 70, but it got less and less as it went on down here. So there's something like a normal curve. Now let's be more accurate and say, I'm going to say the mean of this test was 60 and the standard deviation was 10. Yeah, I'm making stuff up, but, well, you know, I can. So what I'm now going to do is say, let me change color on these. Where's the color thing? Is it hard? Is it unprofessional? Is it time wasting? That wasn't too bad. Let's now do a Z-score row. And I'm going to say the Z-score in the middle was naught. That's what we said last week. A Z-score of naught meant you got the mean score. Okay. A Z score of minus 1 meant you got one standard deviation below the mean, which would be a mark of 50. Z score of minus 2 would be 40. Z score of minus 3 would be 30. Z score of 1, 2, and 3 would be adding 10, 10, 10. So what I've created there is a graph that's more like naught in the middle, 1, 2, 3, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, and it looks like that. Oh. You know that these videos are just meant to be just me walking through the course notes. It may look like it, but they're not actually professionally done. But I do want to get all these videos and turn them into something spectacular. Right now, it's not spectacular. But so that's what I'm talking about. That, okay, we get some sort of curving and say, look, most of the things lay in here around the mean and 1 and minus 1 standard deviations. Yeah, there's still some people around down to 2 and minus 2, and this really getting very unlikely. And you can go beyond 3 standard deviations up and down. It just gets really, really unlikely it'll have anyone there. Well, what we're doing here in this topic is actually putting some percentages. Instead of saying, oh, it's unlikely and there's not many or there's lots of people around here, we're actually going to give us some percentages. Now, I don't know if this is going to work, but what I want to do is use this quincunx. And if it's recording the screen, this should all work fine. Okay, it wasn't happy with me pressing it. Are you still going to open it? Are you? And hopefully here it comes. How's your day? Good? Yeah, mine? Yeah? Yeah, it's good. I might have some video editing to do soon, because, you know, opening a web page, it's a bit of an ask, but I do seem to have pressed it twice. Wow. Okay, here we go. The quincunx. Come on. Okay, let's look at this. This is a ball hitting, say, a wooden peg. And in real life, that's what it is. And it'll either go left or right. Let's say it's 50-50, left or right. Let's get this speed up a bit, please. Okay, and then you drop another ball. And every time it hits a peg, it's got, say, a 50-50 sort of chance of going left or right. And now, sometimes it'll go left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, and just land straight under where it started. And then other times it, I don't know why the net's being so bad. Anyway, it is working. Sometimes it'll go a few to the left. Sometimes it'll go a few to the right. And you can see that what will happen is this thing will speed up. Okay, let's get in there. Okay, we're going to get a lot of them land directly under it. We're going to get a bit of a normal curve happening. This, I can't draw on this page, I'm not on PDF Annotator, but if you can see my mouse key, I'm going to get lots in the middle. Very rarely is it going to go to the side. And then if I just want to put the speed right up, I want to just pretend we've been doing this for ages. And you'll note that, okay, still, it's not beautifully symmetrical at the moment. But if I had done this 1,000 times, 2,000, 100,000 times, it's going to get incredibly symmetrical, and it's going to look like a beautiful normal curve. Now, what's so good about the normal curve is we can then calculate what percentage of the balls landed in certain regions, and you'll find that what happened in this quincunx, in this experiment, does happen in real life. I'll do another example, because that's really just going to go really slow. But you can see it's forming a semi-normal curve, and the longer I let it go for, the better it will get. I don't think I wrote in these notes. I just want to bring up one other example of, look, that's what balls do. Who cares? Say I wanted to test nature. It's a very simplest example, and I just planted a whole area, I got this pot and filled it with, worst pot ever, seeds. And then I measured the height of all of them after 10 days of growing. They were alfalfa sprouts, something like that. Then I want to do a graph, and I noticed that the average looked to be about 5 centimeters high. So I measured one, it was 5 centimeters high, another was 5. I'm rounding to near a centimeter, say. That was 4, that was 6. Ooh, there was a 7. And you can see, as I'm doing this, that I would form, there was a 3, bit of a freak. Well, there's a 10. But the more I do this, the more it's going to form this beautiful normal curve. And I assure you that, say I planted 1,000 seeds, I can predict how many are going to fall in between, here's the mean, in between a z-score of -1 and 1. And that percent, seems like I'm pulling it out of nowhere, but is 68%. Do this enough times, it works out mathematically. And this is, if it's random, if I'm not like watering half of them and not watering the other, if it's just random variation, 68% of my results will lie within one standard deviation of the mean, as in above or below. Then if I say, what about in between two standard deviations of the mean, in between -2 and 2, 95% of my data will lie there. So all but 5% will lie within two standard deviations of the mean. As for 3, well, 99.7%, so wow, nearly everything. Here's our 3 magic percents. So nearly everything lies in there. So maybe you'll get a standard deviation, 0.3, like that's 3 out of 1,000 seeds were maybe less than 3 standard deviations below the mean or greater than 3 standard deviations above the mean. But it's pretty unlikely. Let's go to a prettier picture. And here is that picture. Here's my 68% lying between, here's the mean, so lying between one standard deviation below the mean minus standard deviation, and one standard deviation above the mean plus standard deviation. Now, I like this chart better. This is good, 68%, 95%, and 99.7% of the 3 numbers we were given. And we are still given those 3 numbers on our cheat sheet, our data sheet in our exam. For SEM2, 234, yes, we get a data sheet, and you'll see the number 68, 95, and 99.7 on it. What I like to be able to do is, can you use those 3 percentages and form this? Because if you can form this, you can answer every single normal curve question that comes at you. So what's happened here? Here we're saying, look, 68% lie between here and here. Normal curves are symmetrical, so 68 on 2 is 34, hence there must be 34 each. Okay, well, that wasn't too hard. Then we say, well, there might be 68% within here, but there's 95 between 2 and -2. So the stuff that must lie in this bit and this bit is 95 minus 68, which is 27% lies in this wing and this wing. And again, it's symmetrical, so there'll be half in each end. Half of 27 will go here and half of 27 will go here. In other words, 13.5% go here and 13.5% go here. And we do the same thing again. Since we know that 95% of all data lay between plus and minus 2 standard deviations, then the amount that's got to go in these end bits for between plus or minus 3 standard deviations is 99.7 minus 95, which is 4.7%. Halve that, that's 2.35 in this end and 2.35 in this end. Then all we've got left to do is say, look, under the entire normal curve is 100% of my data. So far we've accounted for 99.7% of the data. The only bit that's left is 100 minus 99.7, which is 0.3. So this end plus this end is 0.3. So it's half of 0.3, it's 0.15. That's how we've split that up. And now, if I could reduce this on any question, it'll answer my questions. Let's make up a question. For example, say it's a maths test, and the mean score for the class was 60. And so let's say the standard deviation was 4. Okay, well, first thing I'll do is say, we'll say the question's then going to say, what percent of students, if this maths test followed a normal distribution, as in it looks like this, what percent of students would you expect to lie here, to lie here, and so on? Well, as soon as it says mean equals 60, I put my mean down here. The mean is 60. That's my z-score, but I'm turning into means. One standard deviation above the mean would be 1.4 above 60. That would be 64, and then 68, and then 72. I'd also leap down fours. That'd be a 56 and a 52 and a 48. Okay, so that's the picture I would draw, and would have questions like maybe question A would be, what percent of students would you expect to get marks between 56 and 60? And I'd say, well, let me look to this one I prepared earlier. Here's 56, here's 60, I expect 34% of all results to lie between 56 and 60. Okay, the question would say somewhere, if this data followed a normal curve, and again, unless there was some external influence, if this was just random results, chances are this is going to be very close to accurate. It can be hard to accept at first. I didn't like it at first, but it'd be true. And then the question might be, well, what percent do you expect to get greater than 60? So I'd expect, basically, this is symmetrical. I'd expect 50% of my data on the right, 50% on the left. So I'd just say, if it said, what percent do you expect greater than the mean? 50. Now, we've got more questions coming up in further examples, so let's go and do them. Okay, here's a really predictable one. I've used car batteries so many times, or whatever batteries, just... Because again, it's like a company can make batteries and they might say, we expect them to go for 5 years. The truth is you can't make all of the batteries exactly the same. There's going to be random variation and not all of your batteries are going to last the same length of time. Some will fail, some will extend way beyond expected life, and there'll be a mean life to a battery. Okay. In this question, the mean life is 4.5 years. So the mean is 4.5 years, and the standard deviation is 6 months. SD, or the sigma, equals 6 months. I'm going to call that half a year, because we want to deal with the same units. Half a year. So my mean is 4.5 years, the standard deviation is half a year, meaning it was really normal for batteries to last half a year under 4.5 years, and half a year above 4.5 years. So let's just go for our picture. It's already prepped there. We put the 4.5 in the middle because it's mean. We jump up by halves, go 5, 5.5, 6. We jump down by halves, go 4, 3.5, 3. And all of those percentages are as we produced before. So the first question, find the percentage, if it's normally distributed, find the percentage of car batteries with a life greater than 4.5 years. Well, that's greater than mean, that's just 50%. Between 4 and 4.5, well, here's 4, here's 4.5. That's just 34%. Between 4 and 5.5, well, here's 4 and here's 5.5. It's this area and this area and this area. I've got to add all those three up. 34 and 34, that's 68 plus 13.5. That'll be 81.5%. And then the last one, more than 6 years. Well, here's 6 years. What percent lies greater than 6 years? Well, it's 0.15%. So 0.15%. Now be careful, did it ask for percentages or numbers? Like in question B, if 2,000 batteries are sold in a month, how many, not what percent, how many could you expect to last more than 5 years? Firstly, more than 5 years, here's 5 years, is those three added together. So more than 5 years is 13.5 plus, well, 2.3, 5.1, that's 2.5. 13.5 plus 2.5, that's 16%. There's also a quicker way to work that out. Given that this is 34% and that everything to the right is 50%, then this remaining bit must have been 50 minus 34, which is 16. Okay, but 16% times 2,000, well, in the calc, whatever way you do it, 16% is 16 per 100 times 2,000. I'm just doing old fraction method. It tells me it's a, when I cancel them, it's 320. So I would expect 320 batteries, in other words, 16% of them, to last more than 5 years. Okay, so that's quite a lot. They're going to last well more than what they're advertised for. Now, question C says, if the manufacturer guarantees to replace any battery which does not last 3.5 years, what percentage could the manufacturer expect to replace? I just want to raise some of my junk around here. What did he say? He said, which does not last 3.5 years. Here's 3.5 years. So we're worried about this bit. What about these ones that last less than 3.5 years? Well, 2.35 plus 0.15, that's 2.5%. 2.5%, if they put in a guarantee to give money, or what is it, replace any battery, they're going to have to replace 2.5% of what they produce. And 2.5%, well, that's 2.5 on 100 again. That's still times, what percentage? Sorry, I'm expecting to run off question B. Just 2.5% will need to be replaced. Which, if it was based on question B, well, it's that 50 batteries that have to replace each month. So that's how our normal curve works. It really is very much still like, I still consider these to be Z scores of 0, 1, 2, 3, and minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. The difference between this one and Z scores is, if someone asks me about what percent do I expect to lay between 4.5 and say 4.75, I can't answer that. I can only answer questions that are these percents, this, and the same things on the other side. I don't have the detail for what percent split is here. Okay, I mean, we can work it out. There's programs, there's other charts that can be done. We don't have it. In this course, we're only going to ask you questions about what percent lie between, and they're going to be whole number leaps of standard deviations. Okay, your question's going to be exactly like what we just did there. So, there's another one here. I'm just going to check, is that the last one yet? Again, I'm telling you, this will be very much the same. Hospital in a large city records the weight of every infant born. Distribution of weights is normally shaped. So there's the bit of data that tells us, yes, it follows a normal curve. The mean is 2.9. Let's put a 2.9 in the middle. Standard deviation of 0.3 kilos. Let's go up by 0.3, 0.3, 0.3. 2.9 minus 0.3, minus 0.3, minus 0.3. The percents are the same, and I promise you, all of the questions must be related to the numbers I've got circled in the blue. Otherwise, I can't answer them. The percent of infants who weigh between 2.6 and 3.2, between here and here, that's 68%. Between 2.9 and 3.5, well, 2.9 is halfway and 3.5 is here, well, it's 34 plus 13.5, that's 47.5%. Under 3.5 kilos, well, the 3.5 is here. So I can either add up everything to the left or cheat and just do 100 minus everything to the right. There's only 2.5% here to the right. What's 100 minus 2.5%? Only 7.5%. Or, yes, you could have said that plus that plus that plus that plus that plus that. You're still going to get 97.5%. Next one is between 2.3 and 3.2 kilos. 2.3 is here, 3.2 is here. We did this sum on the previous page, I think. A 34 and a 34 was a 68, and a 30.5 was an 81.5%. The last one I've got is under 2.6. Well, 2.6 is there. So under 2.6 is that plus that plus that, which is 2.5 plus, we did do this on the previous page. Remember, it was same as 50 to the left of here, minus 34. was 16%. Or just add up those three. That's us. That's normal curves. That's a semester. Pretty nice way to finish, hopefully. And you'll see, no surprises in these questions, that, like here, the mean is 20 and the standard deviation is 3. All of these questions are going to be leaps up or down in 3s from 20. Yeah, you'll see a 23, a 26, a 29, a 17, 14, 11. All right. Hope all is well. Hope the semester's been great. All right. See ya.